When it comes to search engines, Google is the undisputed king, taking a whopping 86% of the market. And that's not even counting a bunch of other search providers who simply buy the results from Google anyway. They're so far ahead of the rest that people don't even say they're going to search for something anymore. They say they'll Google it. Google got here by providing more relevant, higher quality results than the competition. What's interesting is that while the exact details of Google's algorithm are a closely guarded secret, a lot of the technologies they've used are not. They're documented, there are papers written about them, they're open source, you can use them yourself, you can build your own Google experience. Welcome back to the Pro Tech Show. To be clear, I'm not saying you can create a multi-billion dollar company like Google by simply copying a few ideas. You might. But what I'm really saying is organizations have a lot of data, and finding relevant information within that data can be a challenge. Most organizations have some kind of search feature to help with this, and they usually suck. But they don't have to. Unfortunately, it's not as simple as buy product X and now you have Google. To get the most out of it, you have to understand how search works and how to make it work well. Otherwise, you're just looking for words in a bunch of text like it's the early 90s. We're going to talk about three technologies that, when used together, can make a massive difference to your ability to find the right information. These technologies are knowledge graphs, vector search, and natural language processing. I'd like to thank Pureinsights for making this video possible, because not only did they sponsor it, they also provided a lot of the technical insights into how all of this works behind the scenes. These guys are basically search ninjas who specialize in upgrading or Googlifying the enterprise search experience. And these are the technologies they deal with every day when they're optimizing their customer search tools. Let's kick off with the knowledge graph. This graph thing is a phrase that seems to be popping up everywhere. Everything's a graph now. You can't use an API in Microsoft 365 anymore, you have to use a graph, same with Facebook. Obviously, we're not talking pie charts, so what do we mean by graph, and how does it apply to knowledge? Well, the short version is that a graph is a way of mapping out relationships, and when we use this for information, we can model all sorts of interconnected relationships that make it a lot more useful to answer messy real-world questions than just filing things by category can do. Let's use an example. Suppose we ask Google for the age of the actor who plays Neo's girlfriend. Google spits out the answer, no problem, Carrie Ann Moss is 54 years old. But think about what we just asked it. I didn't ask for the age of Carrie Ann Moss. I asked for the age of the actor who plays Neo's girlfriend. Neo is a fictional character in the movie The Matrix. Neo is played by the actor Keanu Reeves. The character Neo is in a relationship with the character Trinity. Trinity is played by the actor Carrie Ann Moss. Carrie Ann Moss was born on the 21st of August 1967, which at the time of recording makes her 54. But I didn't tell Google that it was Carrie Ann Moss's age I was after. I didn't even tell Google about Trinity. Google has figured all of this out using a knowledge graph. The graph stores information about entities like Carrie Ann Moss, but it also stores relationship information between different entities, which allows Google to understand and answer complicated questions like this. Knowledge graphs aren't just limited to answering questions. We can extend this graph and use it to make film recommendations. For example, if we think about the genre of the film The Matrix, we could describe it as an action film and also as science fiction. If I was running a media streaming service and you enjoyed The Matrix, I could traverse a knowledge graph and look for other action or sci-fi films starring Keanu Reeves and suggest them to you as films you might be interested in. This is what the knowledge graph gives us. Information is just a collection of data, facts. Knowledge is awareness, understanding. The knowledge graph helps us model that understanding, so instead of searching for words, we can search for answers to questions. That's the short version. I'll drop a link in the description to Pureinsights' blog post about knowledge graphs if you want to dig a little deeper. You may notice that I used their blog post as a bit of inspiration here. Of course, not everything you search for is a question like this. So knowledge graphs are typically used in conjunction with more traditional search engine capabilities. Essentially, you look to see, is this a question I can use my knowledge graph to answer? If it is, great. If not, fall back to the next approach. That next approach might involve the use of vector search. Vector search differs from a traditional approach to search in that it doesn't compare literal text, but instead compares features of the text. Keyword search relies on indexing words in the text, whereas vector search looks at the text and picks out the key features that has been designed to look for and fills in a scorecard of sorts. This scorecard could be a list of words it's looking for, and each time it finds one, it adds the score for that word. Each word it's looking for is a feature, and the resulting scorecard is the vector. That's a really simple example, but rather than being a list of words, it could be themes, and the resulting vector could show the probability of each theme appearing in the text. When you run a search, instead of looking for results that contain the words you typed, it scores your words to create a vector, and it compares this against the index vectors to find one that looks similar. Let's use another film as an example. Say you're searching for the third Godfather film and you type Godfather 3. A basic keyword search might struggle with that, because there is no film with the text Godfather and the number 3 in it. There is a film called Godfather Part III, which we recognise as Roman numerals for the number 3, but that's not what you typed. Or maybe you're searching for a place to park your car and it comes back with a playground, because you said park and that's a local play park. Vector search can help with this because it deals with features instead of literal words. The word park might be the same, but the features or themes of car park, play park and theme park are all quite different. Another example could be idioms. Let's take a sentence like killing two birds with one stone. That's not a literal sentence, it's an idiom. When we talk about killing two birds with one stone, we mean we're achieving multiple things at the same time. It's a sentence that speaks of efficiency. If you crawl that for keywords, it's probably going to show up in searches about hunting or animal abuse. If we have a vector that understands the concept of efficiency, however, we can score that sentence in its proper context. If I search for how to run an effective IT service desk with limited resources, for example, I might be looking for vectors with high scores for efficiency, customer service, and technology. That would match text that mentions customer satisfaction, solving tickets, and killing two birds with one stone. The literal text is different, but the features are what matters. That's vector search. The interesting thing about vector search is that although there has been a surge of solutions using it in recent years that present it as a modern technological wonder, it was actually invented in the 1950s. To put that in context, my dad was invented in the 1950s. It's been around for a fair old while, so why the sudden interest? Well, vector search is only as good as its ability to understand the features of the information it's indexing. It works well, provided it understands the text, but that's not always as easy as it sounds. Take our two birds, one stone idiom. Vector search beats keyword search there because we have a vector that records a high match for efficiency, but vector search alone can't do that. Without some extra secret sauce, it would be looking at the word kill, and instead of the theme of efficiency scoring highly, it would be themes like murder, violence, or execution. Vector search as a concept has been around for a long time. But what has changed more recently is the ability for computers to understand the way human beings actually speak. This is all down to advancements in a subfield of artificial intelligence called natural language processing. You use this all the time, when you're searching for something on Google, interacting with a chatbot, but one of the most obvious examples is the growth of smart voice assistants like Siri, Amazon Echo, and Google Home. The only reason these things even work is because of natural language processing. Voice control has existed for a long time, but it used to be really cumbersome to say the least. You basically had to talk like a computer and then be prepared for it to shut down your computer instead of opening Excel like you asked it to. It was definitely niche and rubbish. Until Siri came along anyway. I mean, Siri was still pretty rubbish by modern standards, but it was a step forward and it popularized the idea enough that Amazon and Google decided it was worth doing. But better. Natural language processing, I'm just going to call that NLP, isn't specifically about voice. It applies to written text. It's simply about understanding human language. The reason it's so important for voice assistants is because computers have trained us for years to type things in command form to explicitly communicate our intent to them. But nobody actually talks like this. Nobody speaks in Bash or PowerShell. NLP is required for a computer to make any sort of sense out of human speech. And Google's investment in NLP is one of the big reasons why their voice assistant gained so much popularity despite being a bit late to the party. Apple had a head start. Amazon had way more integrations than anyone else. What did Google have? It was actually useful. You could ask it questions and it could answer them. Google had already been using NLP to improve their ability to answer questions in search. So plugging a voice assistant into the search and using their existing natural language processing capabilities opened the door to high quality, natural conversational interaction with search. It's not perfect, it still gives the odd stupid response, but compared to repeatedly shouting at your phone using structured commands in your best contrived accent, only to frantically scream stop and be ignored as it calls a local takeaway for the third time instead of your mum, it's fair to say things have improved. You know what? This could be fun. Let me know in the comments, what is the silliest response you've had from a voice assistant? Give me a laugh and like your favourite ones in the comments. Back to search though. NLP benefits search in multiple ways. One of them is natural interaction. If your search platform understands human speech, you can interact with it vocally. I know I spend far too much time clicking through reports and documents to find answers. How much easier would it be to plug a voice assistant into that data? Finding out how our monthly revenue is looking, or if a given project is on track, could be as simple as asking Google for the weather forecast. It's not just about voice interaction though. Remember, this whole NLP discussion started out as a tangent from vector search, and understanding idioms like killing two birds with one stone. Our documents are full of phrases like this because documents are written for people, not machines. Therefore, if you want to get high quality results when you search through them, you need those vectors to be generated using a realistic understanding of what the document is actually trying to say. Natural language processing is the reason vector search is now so effective. It was the missing ingredient that took it from being a nice idea to a really effective search tool. Pureinsights have a blog post on this as well, so I'll link that also. There's links to further reading too if you really want to get into things like cosine similarity. If you'd like to have a go with NLP yourself, there are plenty of options out there. The big cloud providers have ready-made service offerings like Azure Cognitive Services and Amazon Comprehend. Or you can go the open source route. In fact, Google have made a lot of their own NLP technology open source. Until about a year ago, Google's whole NLP operation for search was using a machine learning technique known as BERT, which they open sourced back in 2018. You can find it on GitHub, along with the lighter version, Albert. Last year, Google switched to a new version called MUM, but both MUM and BERT are based on the transformer architecture. You can play with this transformer stuff for free, and there's an open source platform called Hugging Face with some free services you can use to get started. I have to be honest though, when I heard you could apply artificial intelligence using open source transformers, I was kind of hoping it was Optimus Prime. As for Hugging Face, I'm just glad to hear it was named after an emoji, because I was starting to get visions of Sigourney Weaver pointing a flamethrower at it. 80s movie references aside, how does all of this work together? Well, working together is actually the key. There is no one-size-fits-all answer. That's why it's useful to have experts like Pureinsights to look after your enterprise search applications. Google aren't just using one or two techniques, they're using a whole combination, because different methods work best for different data and different types of queries. I've been telling you how things like knowledge graphs and vector search are way better than a boring old keyword search, but that's only partly true. Yes, they can provide much more intelligent and relevant results. Yes, they can help you find the answer when you don't know exactly what question you should be asking. But sometimes a back to basics keyword search is actually what you need. A lot of you guys are IT pros, right? Well, how many times have you Googled an error message? How many times have you Googled an error message today? An error message is a pretty good example of when you want a keyword search. If I'm looking up an error code, I want results for exactly that code. I don't want results for a similar code. I don't want a vector search that recognizes I'm performing a search for malfunctioning software and decides to show me results about other unrelated but also malfunctioning software. That would be about as much use as those people who respond to questions on Amazon just to tell the person who asked the question that they don't know the answer. Why do you do that? This video has been a bit of a speed run through search technologies, and I'm aware I have skipped over a ton of detail. But rather than a deep dive, I wanted to give you a flavour of what sort of options are out there, and to let you know that this stuff isn't some kind of big secret. It's complicated, sure, but the technology is available, as are people who can help you with it. Speaking of which, if you have any questions or want to dig into any of this in more detail, then please leave a comment and I'll make sure the guys at Pureinsights see it. I'm sure they won't mind fielding a few questions. If you're searching for your next video though, don't, because if you're interested in learning about search, you're probably interested in Elasticsearch and OpenSearch and what the difference is. Luckily for you, I made a video about just that and you can watch it by clicking here. Check the video description for links, check the like button to make sure you've clicked it, and I'll see you at the next one.